Jamie Powell, the athletic director, came to me and in fall of 2013, and he had received a major contribution that was going to allow this project to go ahead. He came to me and said, "Here's the deal. We want to do it. And by the way, we want to have it open for football season 2015. And probably my first thought was, I don't know if that's even possible. As we start thinking about it, kind of back away from it, what could we do? How could we do it? What could we make happen? Who are the people we need to put in place to make it happen? The picture started to come into focus, and we began to think we could do it.
The project could be done, but not without proper leadership, extensive planning and coordination, a ton of personnel, including many ISU grads and interns, and perhaps most importantly, communication.
We are communicating daily with the structural engineer, communicating daily with the owner, and trying to explain why something has to happen. And the other thing we're doing is, something does pop up, we're able to provide different construction details to help solve problems quickly. And there's a lot of team members here, so you've got different communication with owners, architects, designers, even the tradespeople, the last planners, the people putting in the work.
And another key part of being a project manager is keeping relationships with the owner and architect. So on a day-to-day basis, I'm talking with the owner and working through, if something's different than we saw on the plans, it comes up as a change order, we work through those and price them, and that's what we try and manage. And always foreshadowing into what problems we might come up with before they happen, so we can resolve it beforehand.
The biggest thing is to get a good flow going on a project. So you want to make sure this is the right flow. The walls get built, then you put the electrical conduits in, then you put the sheetrock on, and so on.
And in Larry Cormichael's capstone class, we did a lot of pole planning, and that was kind of his big emphasis. In school, we all kind of laughed, like, we're not going to schedule with post-it notes on a board, but within the first couple weeks out here on the site, that was actually one of the first meetings I went to.
During the project, we pull all the contractors back in, do a pole plan is what it's called. It's where each of the contractors write their activities on sticky notes. So try to break them out by like week durations or 2 week durations. And then we get them up all on a whiteboard and kind of adjust them around.
Sometimes a low-tech solution is still the best way to get things done. Other times, new technology offers a superior way to accomplish the task at hand.
Well, I think more of the technology that we're starting to put into the classroom, you can see it out here as far as with the coordination with the VDC. VDC's virtual design and construction. What that does, you take the 2D drawings and you turn them into a 3D rendering or 3D model, to where you can go in and walk around the building before it's even built.
It's growing and it's going to be here to stay. It's virtual design and construction modeling. So basically it's the architect and structural engineer gives you the architectural and structural models that they draw their drawings in Revit. So that what I do is I take Revit files and import them into this Navisworks program that reads files and creates model content.
Once a week, White sends out a weekly work plan, so I'm in charge of setting that up, determining where our guys are going to be, what they're going to be working on, returning that to White's, and then sitting in on the meetings and discussing how that's going to phase out with everyone else's work on site.
Coordinating crews on site can be challenging. Coordinating the South End Zone project was made more complicated by the sheer scale of the project and the accelerated timeline.
We're building the lower bowl right now, all the bleacher seatings, the new stuff that's going in. Typically, you'd want to build that first and build out for logistics sake, but we wanted to keep that open during the season until December. So now all we've got is one access point to get down there. So it's causing a lot of problems with logistics, but it's just kind of those weekly work plans I was talking about, just talking every week about who's going to be where and whatnot to get through that.
And on this job site, it would seem that no matter where you are, you're not far from an ISU alum or current student.
On this particular project, I'm here 2 days a week helping update all of the electronic plans. We don't use many paper copies of the plans anymore, so I help make all of the changes online so that all the contractors have it available to them. We're really a team in there, so everybody has helped as much as they can, and you know, the more you look at the plans and the more you work on the changes, the more familiar I've gotten. And now most of the time I don't need to ask a ton of questions on some of them, but if I do, they'll still help.
Started out in the field as an intern, and then moved into the office, started estimating projects, and then with the project management role, just managing our own labor forces, subcontractors, budget reports, schedules. But it's fun to have that kind of exposure and work. I'm working side by side with other construction engineers. Getting that experience right away, I was able to jump in as a project manager, and I'm already getting responsibility to run my own projects.
I coordinated all the concrete mix designs and which concrete mix was poured where, all the rebar, and make sure that it was getting delivered and installed correctly. And there's a lot of site constraints. We only had a portion of the parking lot out south of the stadium here to be able to work with, and we were fortunate enough to be really the only contractor on site for 3 or 4 months getting the foundations in before the building started to get erected. One of the big things was pouring concrete in this project throughout the winter months and temperatures that are creeping below freezing. And code dictates that a certain concrete temperature has to be maintained from the plant to the job site and then be maintained to cure for a certain time. And one of the big things was the structural deck pours. We started pouring at 5 o'clock in the morning, and we poured the mixes with an accelerant to allow our finishers to be able to get on the slab that day. But that was one of the main reasons that we started the pour so early in the morning, is so that we could finish during the daylight. Everybody knows how cold it was this winter and how cold it can get in Iowa. And especially a job site that's this open, there's a lot of wind, and so the wind chills were some days 20 below up here. But luckily, that wasn't on a very consistent basis this winter, but it was definitely something we had to work through.
I'm responsible for 3 different bid packages on this project. I have the finishes, the general construction, which is Hinkle. I have the roofing bid package and the masonry bid package. So I oversee all of that construction, and I'm here to make sure it is installed correctly and they have all the information they need to install it correctly.
From the first glimpse upon approach to the game day experience to the quality of the playing surface, this is a major project with little room for error.
Obviously the field's down at a lower level than everything around it, like in a bowl, so all the rainwater that comes down inside the bowl has to make it out somehow, and obviously water doesn't flow uphill. And so basically there's drain tiles connecting to a 24-inch concrete pipe all the way around the outside of the field, and there's your sub-drain all under the field. Everything drains into that 24-inch that all comes to the existing pump station up there. What we're doing is getting rid of that one, updating it with a bigger, better one. So now, once this is all piped from the inside, we'll tie back all those pipes into there, and then there's 3 pumps inside of that structure that'll pump the water through this force main here out into the parking lot, into the drainage ditches.
We've got the finishes package. Finishes including all the ceilings, painting, ceramic tile, all the flooring, all the souk-up furnished items, so the ceiling clouds, there's some corrugated metal downstairs, all the millwork, casework, bars. We've got some railings around the concourse, and then all the railings at the upper and lower bowls, and all the ADA access ramps. We've been working since last winter to get everything in order to make sure that it's a successful project here at the end. All the structure's got to be in place, it's got to be enclosed, you know, drywall up. Drywall and metal studs were part of our package, which consumed kind of the front side of our work, and obviously followed by all the finishes. So all the mechanical, electrical, all that's got to be largely complete for us to start our work. From a sub and supplier standpoint, I would say we are in the neighborhood of 50 to 75 guys on site. Definitely takes an army to make it happen. So, and that's just our bid package. You know, there's several trade packages out here right now, and the coordination between all those trades is a major undertaking. So it's definitely an honor to be a part of that, and to be a part of it for the university we're used to attend.
You know, I obviously went to Iowa State, and I actually grew up in Ames. I went to high school here, middle school, elementary school, so it's my hometown. It's pretty cool to be able to drive by, you know, when you're older and say, hey, I helped build that.
Once you complete a project, no matter if it's this project or another, you always take pride in that, and you always mention it to friends and family when you pass it. But this just being sole part of Iowa State tradition, it's going to be fun to come to games and kind of point out what we did and how we had a hand in it.
So it's definitely cool to be kind of a continuing part of this stadium to keep helping build it to what it is now. And it's really cool and it's great to be a part of.
To know that I'm part of a project where so many people from the state of Iowa will get to see and enjoy it has been really fun.
You know, this project's a big project. It's at the front door to campus. It's certainly one of the highest, if not the highest, visibility projects we've done. You know, the challenge is rewarding, going from something that maybe you thought wasn't possible to putting it in place. This is a wow project. And I think, you know, the interest that athletics sees or we see on our webcam in the community, in the state, and, you know, athletics is a key element of the intercollegiate experience these days. And certainly it's something that students look at. It's a recruiting tool. It's a cultural tool that students expect.